The message that I'm going to speak in this video is addressed to those who are of the household of faith, of the household of God. And in saying that, I don't try to make any of us sound any better than any of the rest of the people in the world, because we're certainly not. By the grace of God, we are what we are. We are Christians, we are sons of God. And behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. And the reason I say that is because the things that I'm about to say in this video are not going to make sense to those people who are of other faiths or other religions, or who reject the word of God, whether they call themselves religious or not. Okay, the things in this video, as deep calleth unto deep, the things in this that I'm going to say in this video are revelation from God, and they're only those who have ears to hear are going to be able to hear it. And so if that makes you angry, I have no apology, but I just want to let you know right ahead of time, right at the beginning of this video, that the things that are going to be spoken in this video are not, they're not carnal, they're not intellect, and they're not going to be understood by those that don't know the living God and have ears to hear his word. Okay, so those of you who are born of the word of God, those of you who are in covenant with the living God, Jesus Christ, I bless you in the name of the Lord, hallelujah, and I welcome you to this video, and I want to get started in the first chapter of Genesis. I want to talk to you about something that is widely misunderstood in the denominations and various religions, but the word of God makes it perfectly clear. So I'm going to read from Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. There are a couple of things about this verse of scripture that I want to bring out to you. First of all, the first thing that I have to address, which is a question that is asked by so many, I should say, is when God said, let us make man in our image, who was he speaking to? Well, many people in this world believe that God is a Trinity because of the Catholic teaching that we received from our youth, whether we were Catholics or not. We've all been raised up in a Catholic world. The Bible says Satan is the God of this world, and he is the prince of the power of the air, which means all that we have been taught all of our lives, whether it be through media, music, television, movies, people's conversations, people's religious traditions, all those things were from Satan, the God of this world. But the Word of God is here to wash us as it were water, as the scripture says in Ephesians 5:26, that Jesus Christ is washing his bride with water by the word. Okay, so when we read the word of God, we need to be willing to be washed, which means that we need to be willing to reject the traditions and the beliefs that we had before we came to the word of God in order to believe what the word of God says. And if we're willing to do that, God will bless us and give us revelation, because it is written, light is sown for the righteous. But if we come to the Word of God with preconceived notions and say, well, this is what I believe, so I'm going to read the Bible, but if it says something different than what I believe, I'm not going to accept that, or I'm going to try to twist it around to make it fit into my beliefs, then we bring blindness upon ourselves, and we become as the Pharisees who said to Jesus, they said to that man that had been healed, are we blind also? But they did say it to Jesus, didn't they? Yes, are we blind also? And Jesus said, well, if you were blind, you would have no sin. But now you say, we see. Therefore, your sin remains. And so are all those who say that they see, but are not born of the Word of God, and refuse to accept the truth of the Word of God. But anyway, having said that, God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Who was he speaking to? Well, he was speaking to his son. And there are many times in the scripture when God was speaking to his son before he was ever born. And I'm going to read one of them to you. It's in the second Psalm, verse 7. It says, I will declare the decree. The Lord hath said unto me, thou art my son. This day have I begotten thee. Well, this verse of scripture is God the Father, the only God that there is, speaking to his son, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. But it was 1,000 years before Jesus Christ of Nazareth was ever begotten in the womb. So, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the Son of God, was not there when this was being spoken, but when he was born and he grew up to be a man and searched the scriptures, he saw this and understood that it was talking about him, okay, addressing him. Okay, Jesus Christ is begotten. The Son of God is begotten. That means that he was formed in the womb of a woman and came forth by natural childbirth. That's what it means to be begotten. That's what the word begotten means. Okay, something cannot be spiritually begotten. It has to be naturally begotten. That's what the word begotten means. Okay, so Jesus Christ, the Son of God, was born about 4,000 years after this was spoken by God through the hand of Moses in Genesis 1:26. Okay, let us make man in our image. Okay, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, was not there at the time with God the Father, having a conversation in heaven with him. But this was spoken prophetically to him, and it was read by him about 4,000 years later. Okay, well, how is it that God said to his Son, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, when the Bible says that God created all things by himself? Isaiah 44:24, God says very clearly, I have made all things by myself. I have created them by myself. Okay? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Okay? Not God and somebody else. Not God and his Son created the heavens and the earth. Just God. Okay? God. Well, if we look at Genesis 1:27, it says, so God created man in his own image. Now, notice something. And I'm not playing on words, I'm just reading you what the scripture says, okay? So God created man in his own image. It doesn't say God made man in his own image. It says God created man in his own image. But in Genesis 1:26 it says, and God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Okay, God is trying to tell us something here. God created man in his own image in the beginning. But man sinned. He sinned against the Lord and brought death upon himself, because God said, in the day that ye eat of that tree in the midst of the garden, ye shall surely die. Okay, and that's what happened. Even though the serpent came to Eve and said, ye shall not surely die, the serpent was a liar. And when they ate of that tree, in the day that they ate of it, they died. And Adam brought death upon himself and upon all of his seed after him. So we read in Genesis chapter 5, verse 3, and Adam lived 130 years and begat a son in his own likeness, after his image, and called his name Seth. Okay, so from that point on, after Adam and Eve, everyone that was born after that was born in the image of Adam, not in the image of God, because Adam had sinned and was no longer in the image of God. Okay, blessed be the name of the Lord. So God said, let us make man in our image, and he was talking to his son Jesus Christ, who wouldn't be born until 4,000 years later. But then after he said that, the scripture says, and God created man in his own image. Okay. But after he created man in his own image, and then man sinned and brought forth sons and daughters in man's own image, then 4,000 years later, there came the Son of God to restore what Adam had ruined and to make man in the image of God. Not create man, but to make man in the image of God. To make something is to cause something to become, to take something that already exists and cause it to become something else. Okay? Let us make man in our image. Let us make man to be in our image. Let us cause man to be brought back into our image. Praise the Lord. Now let's go, I know that sounds a little confusing to you and you're kind of going, huh? What is he talking about? Okay, stay with me. Let's go to Colossians in the New Testament. The book of Colossians, chapter 1, verse 15. Okay. Speaking of Jesus Christ, this verse says, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. Okay, and we can all agree that this is talking about the Son of God, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the image of the invisible God. Okay, he's the first man since Adam who was born righteous. Why was he born righteous? Because his mother was a woman, but his father was not a man. His father was God, the Almighty God. Okay, so the seed that begat him in the womb of a woman was not the seed of a man, so it didn't come from Adam. So therefore, he didn't have sin in him. He was tempted in every way like as we are, yet without sin. And so this man was in the image of God. He's the image of the invisible God. So now after 4,000 years of men, all men being born under the curse of death because of Adam, who was in the image of God, but then later on sinned and begat sons and daughters after his own image. Now we have a man who is called the last Adam by Paul in 1 Corinthians 15, who came to undo what the first Adam did. And this man is the image of the invisible God. And so that's why God spoke to his son in Genesis, his son who wasn't even born till 4,000 years later, prophetically, just like he spoke in the Psalms, and said, thou art a priest after the order of Melchizedek. Thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. He spoke these things of Jesus Christ before he was ever born. So that when Jesus Christ came, he would search the scriptures and see that these things were spoken of himself. And now he comes to restore what Adam ruined. And he is the image of the invisible God. So that the sons and daughters of men through him could come into the image that we were originally created to be. Because you and I, when we were born in the flesh, we were not born in the image of God. We were born after the image of Adam. But through Jesus Christ, we can become in the image of God once again. Stay in the book of Colossians and come to chapter 3 with me. Verse 10. And have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. What? After the image of him that created him? And have put on the new man. Okay, if my old man is the one that died when I repented and was baptized in Jesus' name, my new man is the one that is new. Like the scripture says, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away, all things have become new. Put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. Praise the Lord. So because I am a Christian, because I'm in Jesus Christ, and if you're a Christian, because you are in Jesus Christ, you are a new creature, and you are able to put off the old man with his deeds, and put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. So now, once again, you are in the image of God, just like you were supposed to be in the first place. But Adam sinned and brought death upon us, all of us. So when we were born from our mother's womb, we were born in sin, shapen in iniquity, as it's written in the Psalms. But now in Jesus Christ, by repentance and baptism in his name, receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost, we are once again in the image of God. That's why God said to his Son, who wasn't even born yet, but who would be born 4,000 years later, let us make man in our image. He did not say, let us create man in our image, because nobody helped God create anything. God created all things by himself, Isaiah 44:24. God created all things by himself. He did not create anything through a mediator or using anyone else. He didn't have any help. He created all things by himself. Okay, it doesn't say in the beginning God and his Son created the heavens and the earth. It says in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Praise the Lord. So when he said, let us make man in our image, he didn't say, let us create man in our image. He said, let us make man in our image. Which means God created man, man sinned, and then God sent his Son into the world by causing a virgin to conceive and having a male child, which is the definition of a son. And this male child was the Son of God, because God was his father and a woman was his mother. And so he was without sin. And this is the one that the prophets told about that was to come, that prophet with a capital P that was to come. And he was the last Adam, which took away the curse that the first Adam brought and made man in the image of God, as man was supposed to have been from the beginning, and as one man was in the beginning. Hallelujah. Is that coming into focus in your heart, in your spirit? Hallelujah. Let God reveal this to you in the name of Jesus. This is why God said, let us make man in our image. He did not say, let us create man in our image. He said, let us make man in our image. And the next verse, Genesis 1:27 says, and God created man. Okay, so God is the one who created man. There's only one God, the Father. That's the only God there is. Okay. But when the Son of God came 4,000 years later, he made man in the image of God. Again, because he is the image of the invisible God, the only man that ever existed since Adam to be in the image of God. And he laid down his life and took it up again and shed forth his spirit so that we could be also in the image of God. And so God said to his Son 4,000 years in the future, let us make man in our image, before he even created the man. Because he calls things that are not as though they were. He calls the end from the beginning. And the beginning was the Word. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. This is why God said, let us make man in our image. This is not something that you can explain to people that don't know the Lord. But as deep calleth unto deep, if you know the Lord Jesus Christ and you're born of his word, I know that you've heard this message. Praise the Lord. And there's more to it, and I want to share that with you as well. Let's go to the book of Hebrews. Hallelujah. And I believe chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2. I'm going to read verses 5 through 9. For unto the angels hath he not put in subjection the world to come whereof we speak. But one in a certain place testified, saying, what is man that thou art mindful of him, or the son of man that thou visitest him? Thou madest him a little lower than the angels. Thou crownest him with glory and honor, and didst set him over the work of thy hands, over the works of thy hands, excuse me. Thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet. For in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not put under him. But now we see not yet all things put under him. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he by the grace of God should taste death for every man. Okay, let's pay attention to what the writer of Hebrews is saying here by the Holy Ghost. For unto the angels hath he not put in subjection the world to come whereof we speak. Why am I bringing this up? Because God said in Genesis chapter 1:26, let us make man in our image, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Okay? This is what God said. So does man have dominion over all those things right now? Well, let's read. Let's look at verse 8. Thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet. For in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not put under him. But now we see not yet all things put under him. Now. Okay, so God said in Genesis 1:26, let him have dominion over all these things. But 4,000 years later, the writer of Hebrews says, but now we see not yet all things put under him. Okay, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that by the grace of God he should taste death for every man. So that blessing that God gave to Adam in the beginning of Genesis 1:26, let them have dominion, has not come to pass yet unto all men, but it has come to pass unto one man, Jesus, the Son of God. And he is coming again to subdue the earth, to rule with a rod of iron, and his bride to rule with him. And so in that day when Jesus Christ sits on his throne in Jerusalem, and his bride ruling with him over the nations of the earth, over the kingdoms of the earth, then shall be fulfilled that which was written in the book of Genesis, saying, let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the face of the earth. This is why God said to his Son, let us make man in our image and let them have dominion. It wasn't talking about God creating man, one man, in the Garden of Eden. It was talking about Jesus Christ, the Son of God, restoring man to the image of God, making man in God's image, and then causing man to have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. That is something that will come to pass in the future when Jesus Christ comes back with his bride to rule and reign on the earth with a rod of iron. And to him that overcometh will I give to him to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. This is a revelation. This is not something that the people in the various denominations are going to understand. Those that sit week after week after week and gobble up dead bread from their paid entertainers are not going to receive this. But those of you who are in the kingdom of God, those of you in whom the kingdom of God dwells, those of you in whom the word of God dwells, those of you who are of God and can hear God's word, I know that this is blessing you right now. I know that this is unfolding in you right now like a flower. Hallelujah, opening up in you into revelation in the name of Jesus Christ. I have wanted to share these things with you for the last couple of hours, and it's just been rising up in me as I was sitting on my couch meditating on some things. And I know I spoke a little bit about this yesterday in a message that I spoke on a different subject, but since then it's been kind of building up in my spirit until just now I had to make this video. And I hope this will be a blessing to all of those of you who love the Lord Jesus Christ. And if there are any of those of you who have questions, comment on this video, write to me, ask your questions. I'll give you answers from the Word of God. But I want to tell you right now that if you're into theology or if you're into some other religion and you just want to make comments to contradict or blaspheme or whatever, I'm not going to entertain that. So you might want to just go find somebody else, some other theologian to argue with. I'm sure there are plenty on YouTube that you can argue with. I'm here to preach and teach the Word of God. And if you desire to be fed, I live to feed you. I live to feed you. Freely I have received and freely I gave. I'm not the wisest man in the world. God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. I'm barely a high school graduate. I haven't been to seminary. I haven't been to college. I've just been with Jesus. And these things I give to you in his name. Amen.